law will actually lead to an increase in this type of education? And are there fiscal hurdles that schools would face in trying to transition to this?
Stan, you want to talk about this a little bit?
I love this sign, putting kids first. So where we might find a conflicting provision of law, we're going to recommend a change. Where we have regulations that are getting in the way and stifling creativity, we're going to modify them. Our purpose here is really to promote, which is a new generational way of thinking and learning. The last thing we can do is allow vestiges of the past to hold us back and going forward into the future. So with respect to the financial side of this, if you really think about the economy of scale and the number of students who can be reached by ways of the internet or other forms of technology, we can actually extend our reach from the best and the brightest among us, capturing more and more of our students, and at the same time also bringing along other faculty members, paraprofessionals, and the like, so that in the end, we can actually get higher quality, deliver it 24/7, as often as kids need it, at a lower cost.
It's pretty interesting. You know, we find that in healthcare, if you actually work towards reform, you can have higher quality healthcare at a lower price. We believe it's possible to get even better education at a lower price if you are willing to innovate, take risks, and think outside of the box. You know, this is all tough for people because it's hard for people to envision change. Believe me, I'm the change guy, and I know how much people like it sometimes. But once it happens, and I'll give you one little good example of this. We do these programs in the state of Ohio called Six Sigma. We take these monstrosities of